But I agree with Mr. Anish. Honestly, it's not an easy solution, the waterbed, even many discussions. We also are of the view that desal water, we have to desalinate the water. And for all the refineries or fertilizer plants in the country, fortunately, a lot of them have access to the seawater. And compared to the overall impact that green hydrogen would bring, we should be able to do that, right? But inland areas, there is going to be stress. One way of doing this, we believe, is if it's really difficult in some places, would be to look at how we can do ammonia and then actually move around ammonia, liquid ammonia, and then reconvert it into green hydrogen. So that's a little far-fetched, I agree. But there are areas where water is a big constraint in India. So there, it's not going to be easy. Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Coming back to Anish, one more point for discussion is today all refineries are invested heavily in gray hydrogen plants using the conventional fuel. So do we have a plan on how do we use the asset on which huge investments have been made already?
So I think that's a very different question. I would say this question is very much pertinent for the places in Europe and Western countries where we are very quickly migrating towards the electrification of the vehicles. Versus in India, if we see, there are many grassroots refineries coming even now with the gray hydrogen project with a horizon of another 30 to 40 years. So all our assessment kind of says that the gray and green will coexist in the refinery for another 20 to 30 years. Yes, I think what can be looked at is this gray hydrogen, how we kind of capture the CO2 out of it and use some of that hydrogen into the blue hydrogen, provide this CO2 to the CO2 based chemicals production and use this gray hydrogen as a blue hydrogen in combination with the green hydrogen, which has been increasing. So right now, if we see that even currently in India, if there are 7 to 8 million ton of hydrogen, we are expecting that this hydrogen demand is going to grow to probably a 10 to 11 million ton. And that growth rate also coming mainly from the gray, blue, and then we are adding some kind of this mandate discussion from the green. So our thought process is that for the India perspective, the gray will continue to remain. Even like you have seen that in India, under the national monetization policy, government is coming out for the selling out the hydrogen assets, which we company like Linde is very much keen to go and participate those kind of the project, because we do see that there is a other 20 years of gray hydrogen need in India exist along with the tremendous growth rate of green hydrogen.
Okay, your point is well noted. Now we go back to the what we initially touched upon briefly. Round-the-clock availability of renewable power. See, whatever we are going to make green hydrogen for all the industries we are talking about, uninterrupted, 24/7, 365 days supply. So the round-the-clock renewable power, how are we going to manage that? I think Gautam will have a solution for that. We will listen from him.
So, thanks, sir. I know Satish also has touched upon this. It's a very critical component. I agree with the kind of overview he's given there, that first of all, this cannot be driven by a single source of RE generation, either solar or wind. We will have to look at a lot of hybrid models. Of course, place of location plays a very big point of importance, especially from the wind side. Right, but we believe today in India we can touch up to 55% on an average CUF with a hybrid model. Right, that's probably the best we can do at this point of time. Very, very good case could be 60, but on an average 55%. So we need another 30-35% of storage to come from a storage capacity, right? Again, without professing a green course perspective, but what we genuinely believe from a cost perspective for India, having looked at, we are really technology agnostic. Our whole idea was to do our best at looking at various solutions in the world. And currently, if you can keep aside the solution still at a lab level, you know, lithium battery is still going to be expensive in the next decade, we would like to believe. So I think pumped hydro storage could provide the solution for India. It can be re-engineered in a very cost-effective manner that the country is known to do for many engineering solutions to actually bring down this this cost of RE-RTC power. Sort of the total energy required, around 90% CUF, 30% odd can come from pumped hydro storage. I think the government's also realizing this, and there's a lot of discussion today in the MNRE and SECI levels on how to encourage this across the country. A couple of state governments, like in Tamil Nadu and Andhra, also have embarked upon this. So I think in the next decade, in the early stages of decarbonization, I think this could provide the way forward for the country. And we are also hopeful that maybe a decade from now, you know, there'll be new technologies still in the research lab today that will really bring this down cost of storage to that $20, $40, $30, $40 per kilowatt hours capital investments that we all aspire for. So, but the view is, I think it will still a decade away. Yeah. And lithium ion being very limited in supply and mostly controlled, 80% of the refining of lithium is controlled in China today. So that also is a strategic problem for us. We believe that that's not going to come below $130 to $120 per kilowatt hour at best in the next decade. So there really has to be an alternate technology for that.
Yeah, okay. Probably we have 10 more minutes. We'll take two, three questions more and then have wrap-up comments. We just some time back, we discussed about state power grids, infrastructure, additional that will be required. At the same time, the additional banking also they will not allow in this transition period, as renewable will be, as just now we saw, it will be seasonal and fluctuating. So what are the requirements from such DISCOMs and state power grids? How do we, how do they facilitate this? Again, same question to Gautam again.
So actually, yeah, I would like to touch upon this in a slightly larger context, right? For us to reduce this cost overall, I think three things have to happen. One is cost of financing. I think that is extremely important, right? And that has to be enabled. See, today at 8-9% interest rates in India, that is what is adding the most to RE generation and all the other infrastructure. So there is a lot of, for example, in the last round of COP discussions, $100 billion was committed to India. And we understand from Niti Aayog that only less than $1 billion actually materialized low-cost financing, right? So I think that's a critical area that we all need to somehow leverage with the Western world and ensure that those commitments actually translate into outcomes. That's going to be very, very important. Second, from just the banking, there's a technical problem with banking. The problem is DISCOMs already are under a little bit of stress because, as you see today, you know, they give you slots and you have to bank the power and consume the power within the same slot, because as you generate more and more RE power in the peak generation times, we are going more and more out of phase with the peak consumption times. So to be asking for more banking, I think is just, you know, shifting the problem where it's not really solvable. So it's not an easy solution, banking, right? Banking worked when today India has 100 gigawatts of wind and solar out of 350 odd, right? When we had 10 gigawatts, maybe banking was a solution. So banking, I think we should, we have to look for our solutions outside banking, right? But what we definitely need as a solution and support is for green molecule. The green power that we wheel today has no wheeling and distribution charges when the state utility companies offtake it, right? I think a similar kind of policy needs to come from for green molecule. That can drive the cost down of green hydrogen significantly. Today, if you're paying 1.5, depending on the state, on an average, we are looking at a cost of 1.5 rupees for wheeling between state, central electricity duty and losses, right? If that is not a burden, if that burden can be removed at least for, say, half a decade or so, right? I think the green molecules can today, with the today gas prices, which are again abnormal, I know, we can come down pretty rapidly. Power is what is the biggest cost into this. So I think those are the three things which I just wanted to highlight to help us with the overall reduction of cost burden.